So, you seek to understand quasi-connectivity. Well, the thing you need to know about that is...
it's actually not that scary at all. Like, really. Hi, I'm MistRazor, and welcome back to Redstone from Zero. This is a tutorial series where I teach you Redstone, assuming you come into it knowing absolutely nothing about it. Today's topic is quasi-connectivity, which is something where people's eyes glaze over when you bring it up because it sounds abstract and complicated. It's actually not. It's very simple. It's just, well, it's weird. But once you understand how it ended up in the game, it should make a lot more sense to you. It is a bug. It's something you're only going to encounter in Java Edition, and they're probably never going to patch it out because it's a really old bug and lots of builds depend on it. But if you're a Bedrock player, I'd still recommend sticking around because understanding quasi-connectivity will let you look at farms online and be able to say, hey, this farm relies on quasi-connectivity, it's not going to work for me in Bedrock Edition. And you're not going to need someone to tell you whether or not it works in Bedrock, you'll know just from looking at the farm. Okay, now that we've got all that background explanation out of the way, let's get into it. So what is quasi-connectivity? Well, to show you a quick example, it's this. Now, you're probably thinking, what? This is confusing. There's nothing simple about this. Those redstone torches shouldn't have activated those pistons or the dispenser or the dropper. But they did. And yeah, you're right. If it had been any other redstone component, putting a torch there wouldn't have done anything. But the thing is, well, I lied. There actually is one more redstone component that would act the same way as these four. A door. And in fact, the door is the key to understanding these four, and why they act the way they do. Well, let's take a second to talk about doors. In Minecraft, when you have a door, you can activate it from the bottom, or you can activate it from the top. And it needs to work this way, because if you could only activate the top half with the top, then it would just basically be sideways trap doors that you had to activate both separately, or wire up redstone to power both of these blocks here so that way the door would open. But the way that doors are coded, powering one half of it powers the other half of it. Or, in essence, powering the top block here powers the bottom block, is actually the way that it's coded. So, when we look at these guys, you can imagine that there is an invisible second block above them, and if you power that block, they turn on. So why would the devs want to make pistons or droppers or dispensers act like doors? Well, like I said, it's a bug. When they were first implementing pistons and dispensers and droppers, they accidentally used the doors code to control when they activated instead of something like the redstone lamps, which would have been a lot more appropriate. And in fact, that's the way that it works in Bedrock Edition, which is why it doesn't have this bug. And just in case you were wondering, it's not orientation dependent. So, if we have a piston pointing to the side, it still activates when you power the block above it, or the non-existent block above it. And same thing with this pointing down. So it doesn't depend on the orientation of any of these four blocks. It's always the block above them that you have to power in order to take advantage of quasi-connectivity. You can always just imagine that a piston or a sticky piston or a dispenser or a dropper, that there's a door in the place where you placed them, and if that door would open, then the piston or dropper or dispenser will activate. And that's it. That's quasi-connectivity. If you power the block above a piston, a dispenser, or a dropper, they'll activate. However, there's another topic that intersects with that that's going to affect how this is implemented in practice. Specifically, I'm talking about block updates. So, we'll do an experiment here that may give a surprising result. You know, if we... here, grab a lever to make it exactly the same. Whoops. And we'll put a lever here. So when we activate this lever, the door is going to open, right? So when we do the same thing, then this piston should activate, right? Right? Except it doesn't. Not right away, anyway. But check this out. As soon as we cause a block update to happen for this piston, it does activate. So the problem isn't that it wasn't being powered via quasi-connectivity. It was. Is that the game hadn't been told, hey, we need to update this piston. It hadn't received a block update yet. So another interesting thing we can do is, if we have this turned on and then we place the piston down, it activates immediately. And the reason why is because as soon as we place it, it knows it needs to check if it's powered. And so it does the block update and activates. Generally, the rule of thumb is this. If you're going to be directly powering the invisible imaginary block above the piston or dropper or dispenser, then it will activate immediately. But if you're going to be powering a block and that block is going to be what's powering the invisible imaginary block above your piston, dropper, or dispenser, then it's going to need a block update in order to realize that it needs to extend or retract. So the easiest way to send a block update is to just place a block or destroy a block next to it. So as you can see, we can turn off the lever here, and the piston doesn't know that it's supposed to retract yet until we go and destroy this lever that's right next to it, and then it realizes that it should retract. All right, so we've got quasi-connectivity and block updates. What can we do with that? Well, if you've played Minecraft for any length of time with other people, I'm guessing you've probably seen this farm, or something like it. It's the hostile mob farm by Gnembon, or I usually see it in a creeper farm. But essentially, we've got a dispenser here that dispenses water, and then we have a chain of observers pointing up and dispensers pointing up. And each of these dispensers will have a bucket of water in it, and then each of them will have a platform at the same level as the dispenser, which I left out just for ease of seeing. But this whole thing works on block updates and quasi-connectivity. So we've got this powered line here. When I flip this lever, then what's going to happen? This dispenser will have a block update. This observer will see it, and then it will emit a redstone pulse to the invisible block that's above this dispenser. And the invisible imaginary block above this dispenser will power this dispenser, which will trigger this observer, which will trigger this dispenser, which will trigger this observer, which will trigger this dispenser. And what I have here, only this dispenser has a water bucket in it, just because I wanted you to be able to see the center column, because that's where all the action is taking place. And if we had too much water coming out of these guys, it would make it hard to see. So I'm going to flip this lever and you'll see water comes out the bottom. This would be impossible to do without quasi-connectivity. But you don't need to take my word for it. Here I'm in a bedrock world, which you'll recall doesn't have quasi-connectivity. I've built the exact same thing. We've got the center column with a dispenser at the bottom that has a water bucket in it, and a column of observers pointing up into dispensers that are pointing up, going all the way up to the top, where we have a dispenser that has a redstone line leading to it from a lever. So this is literally exactly the same thing. And when we flip the lever in this case, the water doesn't come out. The signal doesn't get down here because there's no quasi-connectivity. And to prove to you that it is the lack of quasi-connectivity that's making this not work, I will add a redstone lamp here underneath the observer to prove that this observer is firing and that there is a redstone signal in this block. It's just not triggering the dispenser with quasi-connectivity, which is what we need to make this machine work. So we'll flip the lever and you'll see it does indeed activate this observer. So if quasi-connectivity were in bedrock edition, then this dispenser here would activate, and then this observer would see that, and this one would activate, and this observer would see that, and then this would activate, sending the water out. But since there's no quasi-connectivity in bedrock edition, I hope I'm not beating this dead horse too much, it doesn't happen. And now let's put that thought experiment from earlier into action, the one where we replaced the dispensers with doors. So I made a copy of this farm and replaced all the dispensers with doors. And now when I flick the lever, you can see that they act just like the dispensers do. They trigger from top to bottom. And there's no real practical use to this. It's more just showing you that, yeah, the dispenser really does act like a door. Before we end, let's review what we talked about in this video. First, quasi-connectivity only exists in Java Edition. Second, quasi-connectivity is a property of pistons, sticky pistons, dispensers, and droppers that allows them to be activated by powering the invisible imaginary block immediately above them. It doesn't matter whether or not there actually is a block there, quasi-connectivity always acts as if there is. 3. Quasi-connectivity always uses the block above those four components, regardless of the component's orientation. You can determine whether quasi-connectivity would power a piston, sticky piston, dispenser, or dropper by imagining a door in its place. If the door would be powered, the piston, sticky piston, dispenser, or dropper will be powered as well. Fourth, if you're directly powering the invisible imaginary block above a piston, sticky piston, dispenser, or dropper, it will activate immediately. If you're powering a block and that block is going to power the invisible imaginary block, it will need a block update before it activates or deactivates. As always, if anything doesn't make sense or if you just have questions, leave a comment and I'll do my best to explain it to you. And if you found this video useful, don't forget to like and subscribe. It really helps out the channel. With that, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!